Hello and welcome to my talk about creating a robot with a Java brain. Okay, to start off a bit about me. My name is Dick Eimers. I work at Luminis since 2011, almost 5 years now. But I have over 10 years of experience on the JVM. Started out as a J2EE programmer. Moved to Spring, had my share of OSGI. Got sidetracked a bit by Groovy and Grails. And recently I picked up Spring, and especially Spring Boot again. If you want to contact me, I'm available on the usual suspect social media like Twitter and LinkedIn. So please do if you want to do that. Okay, so I promised you a robot. And what exactly do I mean by a robot? If you look up the definitions, and there are many, they usually speak of things like it should have a physical presence, right? So it's not some thing that's only software, because then we call it an agent. And we should be creating something that collects data and processes data. And while doing so, it should exhibit some kind of intelligent behavior. But the inside joke in robotics seems to be that that's just a washing machine, right? So I prefer this definition by Gordon McComb, who wrote a great book about hobby robotics. And he says, I can't really define robot, I just know one when I see it. And the seeing aspect of things is really important, because when I was preparing this talk, I thought, well, I have this awesome screen at my disposal, so I wanted to make use of that, and therefore I'll be we'll be seeing a robot coming to existence in 4+1 steps. Four steps to create the initial robot and one step to make a nice improvement. And by showing you the parts, the code, and videos of its construction. So it's kind of an experimental thing for me. But okay, we'll see how it goes. Okay, so for the parts. I obviously started out with searching the internet and ordering all kinds of parts. Some were a success, some were blatant failures. I won't show you the failures, I'll only show you the design of the thing I think worked out quite nicely. So we start off with the base, which consists of a Raspberry Pi. We add a Wi-Fi dongle wireless connectivity, obviously. I paid somewhere near €35 for those things. And the interesting thing is that we'll be charging it using an USB charger. These chargers are typically used for emergency charging your phone, but they can be used to power the Raspberry Pi. Next, we'll be adding an LED. Well, I assume most of you are software guys, just like me. And in software, we have Hello World. We print something to the standard out. And in the electronics world, they have the blinking of an LED. And once you have shown that you can blink an LED, you've proven your concept. You prove that you can drive some external device, and hereby you can drive anything you want. Well, next, we want to make it move around its environment. And to move around, I selected a chassis with two matching micro gear motors to match. And we'll be adding a motor controller board to control the motors. And finally, to actually make it an autonomous vehicle, we'll be adding a ultrasonic distance sensor. Well, I promised cheapest chips, so I've added the prices I paid. The total net cost of the robot we'll be building is somewhere near 70 or 75 euros. Okay, why the Raspberry Pi? I get this question quite a lot. It seems there are a lot of Arduino fans out there. So I get asked the question, why not use an Arduino? Well, the reason why I prefer the Raspberry Pi is because it's a full-blown computer. Right, so it's a full-blown computer. I'm sorry. It's a full-blown computer based on the ARM-powered processing hardware, on top of which I can install the Linux operating system, which I like very much, on which we can install the Java virtual machine, since Oracle, maybe 2 years ago, they released a ARM-targeted version of their Linux-targeted JVM platform. Right? So the real reason is because we can program Java on it. for those of you who haven't seen such a pie of up close, I'll give you a really short tour. It's powered by a 700 megahertz ARM processor. I overclocked it a bit. You can do that up to 1200 megahertz. I overclocked it to 900 megahertz, and you can do that by losing the warranty, but you have to do no additional modification. It has quite a few bits of RAM, 512 megabytes to be precise. Well, obviously, recently there was a new version of the Raspberry Pi that was released, the Raspberry Pi 3. It's much faster. It has not one but four processors. And the great part of the new Pi is that it has Wi-Fi on board. The downside is that it uses almost twice the amount of power. So you can create your happy robot will be driving around half the time. Right? So it's really fast, but it won't be driving around that long. Such a Raspberry Pi is powered by a 5 volts micro USB power source. It has HDMI and audio connectivity, but we won't be using that. What we will be using is one of the four USB ports, because we'll be adding that little Wi-Fi dongle to create the wireless connectivity. The most important thing, and the thing we can use to interact with the physical world are these 40 pins. So these are really important. I'll take a closer look at these. Okay, so there are 40 pins. They're numbered. They're numbered quite strangely. I'll be showing you the numbers of the pins today, but you can forget about the actual numbers, right? The only thing that's important is that there are different kinds of pins. So the different kinds of pins that we can see on the left side, there are two red pins, which are two constant 5-volt power sources, and there are two orange pins, which are constant 3.3-volt power sources. And there are 26 general purpose input-output pins, which I'll be telling you something about later on. And there are eight ground pins. And the ground pins come in handy when you create a little electrical circuit. The 26 general purpose input-output pins, those can be programmed for output or input. When programmed for output and set to on, they'll emit 3.3 volts. And when set to off, they'll be emitting 0 volts. And the other way around, when programmed for input, they will read on or truth once provided with a voltage somewhere near 3.3 volts, and it will be definitely be reading off when you provide it with something near 0 volts, and anything in between that really depends on the chipsets you'll be using. So just let's stick to the exact numbers here. Okay, so here for the obligatory warning slide. Because it's not to blow up your Pi. I can assure, maybe you'll be such an enthusiastic about this talk that you'll be starting to create such a robot when you get home. But be sure not to blow it up. And the reason is that these Pis operate on the what's called non-standard 3.3 volts. While most of the sensors you can buy off the internet are actually intended for use by Arduinos, which are powered by 5 volts. So, Since these sensors are typically returning some reading to one of your pins which you've programmed for input, you should be cautious to get rid of a few volts. Otherwise, you may damage it. And finally, well, I'm a software professional, and the electronics part is just a hobby. So don't trust me with the electronics. Okay, so I promise you four plus one step. This is the first step. The first step is creating the base. For the base, we'll be using the Raspberry Pi, and we'll be adding the Wi-Fi dongle, and we'll be having the USB charger to power it. Furthermore, I'll be cutting a piece of this cardboard you see right here, in order to which we can wrap around the Pi, and hereby create, let's say, a minimalistic case. And this is handy because we can hold it once it's powered on without damaging it, or just without damaging it. And it's really handy later on because we can use this to stack things on top of that. The rubber band will be used to hold things together. Okay, here you can see me cutting the case. Here I'm cutting a few pieces of cardboard. I'll be taping to create a solid base with the battery in the middle. And now I can stack the pie on top of that. So this is where it started. Well, from here on we could have gone anywhere, right? But I decided to choose the path of creating a robot. Okay, so for the hello world of electronics, we'll be adding a LED. The parts we'll be needing to add the LED are obviously a LED, and we'll be using a breadboard and jumper wires. And these are really handy because you can create a circuit without soldering. It's also nice for prototyping, but as you can see, it works really nice for creating this robot. Finally, there's a little resistor with a small resistance value, which is used to prevent the LED from burning out. We want it to burn bright, but we don't want to burn it out. Oh, for those of you who don't know how such a breadboard works, the pins are connected the way I depicted with this the red lines, right? And it's for all these pins. Okay, so on to the wiring. The wiring scheme. As you can see, we'll be using the breadboard to create a little circuit, and we use the resistor to direct the current. And we'll be using two pins, the two bottom pins. Like I said, the exact pin numbers are not of any importance. If you want to know, it's pin number 21. But the important part here is that we'll be using a ground pin and a programmable input-output pin, which we'll be programming for output. Such that when enabled, we can emit some light from the LED, right? So the LED will be on. Here we go. Okay, you can see how I'm removing a piece of plastic. It's because the breadboard has some adhesive tape on the bottom, which can then we can use it and stick it on top of the USB ports. Okay, so this is a developers conference. So I felt obliged to show you some piece of code. The thing is that, like I said, I wanted to use the JDK, the Java Virtual Machine. There is a version of the Java Virtual Machine available for the ARM processing architecture, but it's the standard edition. And the standard edition, as most of you probably know, is intended to create the desktop and server-side applications. But there is no library for accessing low-level peripheral devices you find on embedded devices such as the Pi. So the solution I found was in using the OpenJDK Device I/O, also called DIO, which is a library which is was intended to be used with the Java ME, but it can be compiled against the JDK 8 for ARM. So you can check out the source and execute the right commands to compile it natively on your Pi. This will be resulting in a native library you should add to your Java library path and a jar for your Java programming pleasure. Okay, so here's this little snippet of code. You can see that I'm importing two classes, mainly a GPIO pin and a device manager. And here I'm using the Java 7 try with resource expression to assign such a GPIO pin reference using the device manager open method, where you provide it with a pin number. So this will open pin number 21 and assign a reference to the pin variable. And next you can see how I'm setting the value of the pin to true, go to sleep for a second, and set it back to false, such that it will be emitting light for exactly 1 second. Okay, blinking a LED is awesome, but let's make it move. To make it move, we'll be adding tracks. Okay, to add tracks, I selected this little chassis kit. It can be bought with these tiny DC motors, and these fit together nicely, so there's no need to do additional modification. The great thing with this chassis kit is that it's actually a battery compartment, so we can fit four AA 1.5 volt batteries inside it, and hereby creating an additional 6 volt power supply. And that's really important because we'll be driving motors, and motors draw quite a bit of current. And while trying to power the motors from the same energy source as powering the Pi, the Pi will crash, right? So it will draw through too much current and leave nothing for the Pi. And this is all connected together using this so-called tool L298N motor controller, which I'll show you when I talk about the wiring. Okay, so this is quite a bit of wiring. I promise you this is the most complex wiring scheme I'll be showing today. But I think that if you look closely, that is actually not that difficult. You can see on the right-hand side the chassis with the motors attached to it. There is the power source, which is connected to the motherboard. These two motors are also connected to the left and right-hand side of the motor controller board. And on the right-hand side, you can see four pins. And these four pins are used to actually control the motors. Well, to explain how this works, I'll zoom in and show you one of the two motors. This is in electronics, they call this an H-bridge. And what happens here is that there are these two separate circuits which can be connected. While the one circuit, which is the circuit driven by the Pi, and the two wires, the red and the green wire, that's only controlling the circuit on the right-hand side, which is the circuit powering the motors, and which has a bit more volts because it's a 6 volt instead of the 5 volts. Okay, so to explain how this works, this is actually a circuit. Assume that a current is connected. But the red, the blue and the green wires are controlling two switches. These are actually not real switches, but these are transistors. Well, transistors are kind of a big deal, right? Because they were invented during the Second World War and led to silicon, the emerging of chips in Silicon Valley. Anyway, I'm sorry, being sidetracked. The thing is that you can enable some current on one of these wires, and they will be actually closing these two switches. So in this situation, there's no current running in any direction. But when we close the blue switches, so we're actually enabling the pin connected to the blue wire, we can create a circuit in which the current is flowing in some direction. Let's say it's the right, we're going to the right. What we can do is you can disable the blue switches and enable the green switches. And in that case, the current is flowing in the opposite direction. And that is really handy because these DC motors, the direction in which the motor is running is depending on the polarity of the circuit, so the direction in which the current is flowing through the circuit. So this way, we can use two wires to either stop, move forward, or move backward one of such motors. Well, and this motor controller board has two of such H-bridges on its chip, and this is this is how it works. Okay, on with the video. As you can see, it really comes as a kit, so I had to do some soldering. Don't mind the burn stain. You can see the motors being fit right into it, no additional modification needed. Okay, now we have finished the chassis. We put the base on top of that. And on top of the base, we put this motor controller board. So now we have the full stack. Please answer. Okay, a final step in creating something which is really autonomous, which is adding ultrasonic sense, a sensor to sense our environment. I selected this ultrasonic sensor. It's called the HCSR04 because it's cheap. I paid, I think, €3, but I've seen them go for less than a dollar if you buy them in bags of 20. And, well, I think it looks cute. On to the wiring. As you can see, this sensor is plugged right on top of the breadboard. And there are four additional wires. Two wires are connected to either a ground or a 5-volt power supply pin. And two wires are connected to the trigger and echo pins. Okay, so how does this work? Like I said, it's an ultrasonic sensor, so it will be emitting sound waves. To enable the sensor, you have to put a really short signal of 10 microseconds on a trigger pin. So just signal it for a really short time. Then the sensor is activated. It will be emitting a burst of ultrasonic sound waves. And then the echo pin comes in. The echo pin is by default in the off state, so it'll be off. But once the ultrasonic sound waves are sent out, it will go to the on state. Well, next we have to measure the time it takes in order to receive an echo. So maybe there is something in front of it. The echo returns. Well, that means that the sound waves have been traveling through sound for some while, and in order to to calculate the distance, all we have to do is measure the duration and multiply the duration by half the speed of sound, because you go there and back again, and the obstacle is obviously the distance of the obstacle is the half of the path the sound waves traveled. Okay, I'll be connecting the power, and once it's booted, you can see me running a little test program to test the wiring, and which will be blinking the LED once there's an obstacle measured in front of it. Okay, so there's one little thing I omitted. It wasn't the whole truth I was telling you, and it has to do with this tiny piece of resistance soldered on top of the sensor. Like I said a few slides back, we have to protect the Raspberry Pi from being damaged. And as you could see in the wiring scheme, this sensor is powered by a 5-volt power source. So to put it simply, we have to get rid of 1.7 volts. Well, the easiest thing to explain how you can do this is obviously a trick, a well-known trick in electronics to get rid of such amount of volts. Is that by default, obviously you have a wire that the input is some voltage, the output is the exact same voltage. But what you can do is create an additional little circuit where you connect a ground pin, and you put in two separate two resistors, R1 and R2. And by selecting the right ratio between R1 and R2, you can create any fraction of the input. So you can create any fraction of 5 volts. So the solution is to add the right resistance. Well, we could obviously have just created this little circuit on the breadboard. But my colleague Hugo showed his elite soldering skills by soldering it right on the sensor. Okay, on to the programming part. Programming the Java brain. The easiest way to create some form of intelligence is by applying a stimulus response model. And in our case, the stimulus is the detection of some obstacle. And the typical response would be to get away. So before showing you the code, I'll show you this little class diagram where we see how I've modeled the parts that create a robot in little classes. In this case, there's, for example, a LED that's connected to the LED pin, and we can use to make a LED blink. There is a motor class, and we'll be having two of those for the two motors on both sides of the tracks, which you can use to stop forward or reverse that specific motor. And a bit more interesting, I guess, is the class on the right side, where you can see how the sensoring works. So I've created an abstract base class called sensor, which is a generic class, so it has a template type T, where which has its own thread, and which you can start. And by starting it at some interval, you can create an event loop to do some kind of measurement. And exactly what the measurement is you will be doing depends on the concrete subclass, right? So in this case, the distance sensor, based on the ultrasonic distance sensor, will be sensing by triggering and waiting for the echo in terms of, in this case, a double representing the distance of the measured distance. The interesting in the sensor class to mention is that since once you've started the sensor, you can add a sensor callback where you define a filter and a callback method in terms of a consumer. So you can have a filter in terms of T, so in case of the distance sensor, a filter in terms of a double, where you state that you're interested in maybe measurements which are smaller than 20 and bigger than 10 centimeters. So anything in the range of 10 and 20 centimeters, you can get a callback to the consumer function. And the consumer function, like it says, is one of those new functional interfaces to describe a lambda expression that will just be provided with something of type T, in this case a double. Okay, I'll show you the code. Okay, I'll start with the LED. As you can see here, there is a GPIO pin called LED pin. The constructor assigns the pin using the device manager open method, given quite a number of parameters. But the only thing that's really important is that we'll be this is a GPIO pin, and we'll be programming it for output. Right, so we'll be emitting current. Well, like I said, there's a blink method. The blink method. You use the blink method to enable the LED for some time, given the interval, or given the duration and the number of times you want to repeat this. And actually, the code to enable the pin is pretty straightforward. But what you'll see me doing quite a lot is that this code is actually executed by an executor surface. And the reason for that is that we don't want to drive into something damaging our robot once we only want it to be blinking our LEDs, right? So we'll be creating a new thread to execute the LED blinking pattern and continue processing events. Well, next the motor. This is pretty straightforward. There are two pins programmed for input and output. Two pins programmed both for output. Remember the green and the blue wire in the wiring scheme of the motor controller board. And here we see the stop, forward, and reverse. Let me take a look at the forward, for example. You can see me enabling the forward pin and disabling the reverse pin to set up the H bridge to create a circuit with the polarity the way we want it. Well, now for the distance sensor. Here you can see that there is a trigger pin and an echo pin. Sorry. The trigger pin is programmed for output, and the echo pin is programmed for input. So, like I showed you in the diagram, the trigger pin should be signaled for some really short time, 10 microseconds. And once it's signaled, we'll start waiting for the echo pin to be enabled. And from the moment on it's enabled, we'll start to wait for it to be disabled again, right? For the pin to be set back to off. And from that moment on, we can calculate the distance by subtracting the stop from the start and multiplying that by the speed of sound. And we'll be dividing that to 2 later on and wrapping it in a double. Okay, now for the actual robot. Let me see. Okay, so this actual robot has 2 states. I've been modeling this using a simple state diagram. We'll be either exploring or we'll be avoiding an obstacle. Okay, so as you can see, there are motors, distance sensor, and the LED. You can see me doing this all the time. That has to do with adding a shutdown hook. I showed you the code with the try with resource statement, which is really cool, obviously, because you assume that the resource is brought back to some default state in a final block, but that's not really the case when you signal the program to stop, right? So I typically use Control C to stop my programs, and I ran into the problem that the resources were not freed the way I like to know. They weren't reset to the to an acceptable default value. So therefore, all these things have a shutdown method in which we do some cleaning up. But the interesting part in this little robot is the use of the sensor. On which we can register a sensor callback. In this example, you can see that the distance sound sensor will be started, and it will be started with the value of 100, so it will be 100 millisecond interval, so it will be called 10 times a second. So there's an event loop, and it will be measuring a value every 10 times every second. And the interesting part is to register the sensor callback. In this case, you can see that I'm adding a filter. And the filter just says that the double shouldn't be nil, and it should be smaller than 10. So if we run into an obstacle which is smaller, is closer in range than 10 centimeters, then a callback method is called. And the callback method is what you can see here. The callback method will be checking if the state is actually exploring, because if we'd be avoiding another obstacle, we'll let it go. But if the state of the robot is actually exploring, we'll be spawning in just another thread, in which first we'll blink the LED for 3 times for some time, for a duration of 200 milliseconds, to indicate that we're a bit scared, and then back off. And the backing off, first we'll be reversing, and then turning a bit, depending on some random value between 1,000 and 1,500. Once that's done, we'll continue to move forward. So this is it. I'm going to demonstrate it to you. So now I first have to, okay, so here it is. I booted it. I've created my own network. So hopefully this all works. Okay, so now I'm logged into the Pi. I'll run the main fixed distance sensor program I showed you, and we'll switch to the camera. Oh, that's buggers. Ah. Okay, so anyone who likes to tell me what the problem was?
Not wide enough.
Yeah, right. So the sensor has quite a narrow viewpoint, right? So if there's a obstacle just a bit off, well, then it won't sense the obstacle. The distance sensor won't sense the obstacle. So that's a problem. Well, problems are there to be solved, right? So, we have a problem, and the solution is to make the sensor sweep. And making the sensor sweep will allow us to look around a bit and to improve the obstacle avoiding robot. Okay, what do we need? We need a little cardboard box. And this little cardboard box was provided to me by my local supermarket. And we'll be using a servo motor. And a servo motor, which is a cheap little motor, which has two qualities. It's really fast, and it can be set in some exact position. So you can set in any position given a range of 0 to 180 degrees. So for the wiring, we'll be powering this servo motor given the circuit we also use for powering the other motors, because again, this is a motor, and a motor draws quite a bit of current, and it would make the Pi unstable. The more interesting part is with the single wire that drives this, this controls this motor. And this is how that works. It's called, it's a well-known principle in electronics called PWM, pulse width modulation. And at a 50 hertz cycle, so this happens 50 times a second or once every 20 milliseconds, the servo expects a signal. And based on the length of the signal, it will position the servo motor's arm. Right, so you can create, you can put it in any position given the length of the signal. And the exact values obviously depend on the type of servo motor, but I found out it also depends on just which one you got. So you have to experiment with that a bit. Okay, this may go by quite fast, but what we'll see is that I'm going to remove the arm of the servo motor. I'll be gluing that on top of the little cardboard box. I'll be pushing the distance sensor inside the cardboard box, and we'll be connecting it all together. I'm also using a bit more cardboard to make the servo motor fit. You saw how fast that glue was drying? Well. Okay, a little peek at my recording studio. But this is the result. So, back to the brain. Again, we'll be implementing a stimulus response model. This time the stimulus will be to detect an obstacle, but we also have the relative position in which we detected the obstacle. And next is to avoid the obstacle, right? So we can make a decision based on not only the obstacle we detected, but also the position it was in. Well, the second version of the software, I skipped the LED and the motors. What's interesting here is that there is some kind of sweeping distance sensor, which is again a concrete subclass of the sensor. But this time it's composed of both a servo motor, which you can position to some angle, the move to angle function, and the distance sensor we used earlier to sense some distance. Again, it's in terms of the template type T. Last time we used the double value representing the distance in centimeters. This time I've created this direction distance tuple thingy that's just the direction in degrees combined with the double representing the centimeters of the distance we measured. Okay, so now we can sweep. We also have to pick some sweeping pattern. I've experimented with this a bit, and it turned out that this is really effective, where we'll be measuring straight ahead, we'll be measuring quite a little bit to the side, and we'll be measuring quite far to the side in order to check if there's something on the left or right of us. And these three in the middle take care of the problem we had earlier. Okay, back to the code. Okay, I'll skip the servo motor. There are quite a few values here. These have to do with the length of the signal. So this is the minimal length, so representing 0 degrees. And this is the maximum length, representing 180 degrees. And I found out that it was not evenly distributed, so I get better results if I also use measure the value to represent 90 degrees. And every intermediate value is just calculated based on this. Okay, here you can see that in the main sweeping distance sensor program, I've created this inner class called sweeping distance sensor, which is, like I showed in the design, a composition of both the servo and the servo motor and the distance sensor. You can see the direction distance tuple I told you about, which is really just a double distance and an int direction. Here is the sweeping pattern I showed you, which is actually really a cyclic pattern, so we can just ask for the next value to move towards. And that's what we can see here in the sense function, which will be using the servo motor to move to the next position based on the sweeping pattern and sense the value. Okay, so one thing to note, you can see here the sense function also takes another parameter. That's because this is a special version of the sense function, which uses an executor surface, because, well, if the sense function does not return a value within 20 milliseconds, it's either really far away or there's some error, so we're not really interested in that. So to keep things responsive, I added this additional method. Okay, I'm going to start it. In the meanwhile, talk a bit about the code. This may take a while. Okay, so on to the actual robot. Again, we have these two states. We are still just exploring or avoiding an obstacle. We have the same motors and LED we used to have, but now we have this sweeping distance sensor. And this is where it's interesting. So there's not just one, but there are multiple callbacks this time. And in this case, I've just inlined the parameters. So the first argument is this filter, which shows that given some direction distance tuple, we want this callback to be called if it's not nil, if the distance is closer than 15 centimeters, and if the direction is 90 degrees. So if it's straight ahead, we want this function to be called. And this turns out to be close to the same function we used earlier. So it's just the back off and move away function. But this one is maybe more interesting because now you can see that there is another callback that, given a direction distance tuple, will respond if the distance is closer than 25 centimeters and the direction is greater than 90. So it's on our left side. And once on our left side, there's a specific callback implementation that will blink just once. And depending on the distance, if it's really close, you're still going to make some exit maneuver. But if it's not that close, we're just going to move a bit to the other, to the opposite direction. And that will be based on the actual distance. So the distance we measured will be used to compute the time we use to turn the robot. And the same goes for the other direction, but then in the exact opposite way. Okay, so I hope the robot has now connected. No, it didn't. Okay, since the robot is starting up, and this will take a little while, I didn't show you the distance sensor. I showed you the distance sensor, but I didn't show you the abstract base class, so maybe it's fun to look at that. You can see this abstract base class sensor in terms of type T. That's a base class for anything that senses and uses its own thread to interact with the sensor at a scheduled interval. Here you can see the start function, which uses the provided interval in milliseconds and starts and uses the executor surface to schedule the sense task at a fixed rate of this interval. And the sense task is shown here. There's also a denoise function. I haven't told you about that, but you could use some denoise function to take the average of let's say the last three message distances. But the interesting part is right here, where you can see how the callbacks are called for each of the callback that where the predicate holds. Okay, it talked enough, I guess. Right, so now I have two, so I have to be sure that this is the correct one. Well, the simplest thing is to blink the LED. Yeah. Okay, so there's something that I have not told you, that because using a servo motor, we have to use the pulse width modulation. And pulse width modulation requires really precise timing. I could not get it to work using the JVM. So I'm using an external driver and a file writer to operate this from the JVM. Right. So I'm starting this, and it's called a Servo Blaster, which is an open source project that allows you to operate PVM on a device file. Anyway, run main sweeping distance sensor, and I'll be switching to the video. Okay, so it's not perfect.
It's not the robot.
in the log you can see the obstacles being detected and the distance. Right, okay, so it's quite an improvement, but it's not perfect just yet. Well, that brings me to this slide. Believe it or not, at home, it works. And that has to do with the fact that I have not tested this robot running on carpet. And on my wooden floor tiles, it's much faster. And you can sit there by it and watch it run around for half an hour. So that's one of the insights that playing with robotics gave me, that this robotics is more or less dealing with uncertainty. Every action is uncertain, like I said. If you enable the motors for some period of time, the actual distance you traveled depends on all kinds of things. It depends on whether you're on a hardwood wood floor or on a carpet, but it also depends on the exact amount of voltages left in your power supply. So there are all kinds of things that are influencing the actual result. And that's something that me, being a software guy, I'm not really used to, right? So I know that when using threads, there are some kind of non-determinism going on. But usually that's in theory, but in practice you're probably all right. But when using and interacting with the physical components in the real world, then things get much more uncertain. Well, if you combine that with the sensor measurements, which are also uncertain, then you're just applying uncertainty over uncertainty. And that's what's called the uncertainty ellipse. So once you're traveling from one point to another, to another, to another, the exact position you'll be in will be more uncertain in every step. And then there's the JVM, which I have I know a lot about and have been paying my bills off for at least a decade now. And I have to admit that the JVM adds an additional uncertainty. And that's shown by this little experiment I did. I conducted this experiment where I measured the same fixed distance of 48 centimeters for 100 times at a 100 millisecond interval. And as you can see, the left-hand side is my Java implementation, which is, well, kind of okay, with some excesses at the bottom there. But the Python implementation, please forbid, is, well, pretty constant. So I don't know why. I haven't investigated why. I have some ideas why, but well, it's just a fact. So to wrap things up, we did create a robot using Java. It is exhibiting stimulus response type of behavior. I think it fits the reactive style of programming with Java 8 lambda expressions really well. And well, to say the least, we have only scratched the surface, right? So robotics is a vast subject. Robots are on the moon. An ultrasonic distance sensor won't work in space for obvious reasons. But yeah. Okay, so from here, if you're interested and if you like to do this for yourself, I have put a code on my GitHub page, and I actually added the installation guide to prepare your Raspberry Pi such that the source will actually act like the robot we just saw. We have 5 minutes left. I didn't think this was my most funny slide. Please.
Is there any specific reason why you picked the audio sensor instead of, for example, photo sensor?
Yeah, right. So the question is why I picked the ultrasonic audio of the ultrasonic distance sensor using sound waves. I didn't select something like a laser. Well, yeah, it's just because I thought these two eyes were so cute. Yes, please. More questions? Oh, please.
What about the exact timing issue you had with tools with modulation? Do you think that's easily solvable with YAML? Or do we have to be very
well? Well, the thing is that if you if you're willing to pay some money, you can get a Java virtual machine with more real-time characteristics. But the freely available version was not with the freely available version, I was not able to. Sorry. I was not able to get it to work. Yeah, in the back. Yeah, well, the next step would be to get rid of the stimulus response model and to create an actual map of your environment and act upon that. But it's not a little step. It's quite a leap. It's one giant leap, I guess. Yeah. Yeah.
What's the reason that you choose to do all the intellectual things in your robot and not on the online server?
I'm sorry, like what?
You chose to program on the robot itself.
Yeah.
But you could also choose to drive a client on the robot, which communicates with itself.
Yeah, sure. But then it won't be really autonomous, right? It will be directed. And this is, I wanted to create something which is autonomous. No further questions? Okay, 2 minutes, thank you.